Friends, I am Deepak Kannan from Faculty of Finance, Baroda. We are meeting for the 28th module in the course in Aesthetics and Philosophy for the PG course in Visual Arts. In the previous session, we talked about absolute idealism and Immanuel Kant. And as I told you, that Immanuel Kant is considered to be responsible for changing the course and concerns of the aesthetic inquiry. Obviously, the whole generation of aesthetes in the 19th century was deeply influenced by Kantian philosophy, Kantian thought, and Kantian ideas. You can count a number of scholars, but three of them are very important. Benedetto Croce, who worked in 19th as well as in 20th century. He lived a very long life of about 90 years. Then Collingwood is another important scholar, and Bernard Bosanquet. These three scholars, Kantian ideas, and they also contributed with their own ideas to the notion of absolute idealism. Benedetto Croce, unlike the other philosophers, was a full-time aesthete. Normally, till now, we know that in the Western tradition, the aesthetes are basically philosophers. Unlike the Indian tradition, in Indian tradition, the aesthetes are full-time aesthetes. They talk about art, art, and art only. On the other hand, in the Western tradition, Plato speaks about every aspect of life, and art being one of the aspects, comments on art also. The same is true about Kant, the same is true about the other philosophers, barring some exceptions like the Renaissance aesthetes who talk about art only. Barring the early medieval scholars like Horace and Longinus, or the Renaissance scholars like Ficino, the rest of the Western scholars have not necessarily talked about art and art only. Benedetto Croce calls himself an aesthete, not a philosopher. He's a full-time aesthete and he talks about aesthetics. His theory of intuition is his contribution. Theory of intuition borrows quite a few things from the Kantian philosophy. Rather, it is almost an extension of Kantian philosophy, but it reminds me of the relationship between Bhartrhari and Anandavardhana, that Anandavardhana's aesthetic theory is based on Bhartrhari's philosophy. Similarly, Croce's aesthetic theory is based on Kantian philosophy. It is essentially an aesthetic philosophy using Kantian ideas. But Croce, like Kant, speaks about the three different knowledges. We know that normally intuition is not considered to be a knowledge. Croce talks about the conceptual knowledge, the perceptual knowledge, and the intuitive knowledge. We have already discussed about it. The perceptual knowledge is the knowledge that we derive with the help of our perception, which is the everyday knowledge. The conceptual knowledge is the further step of perceptual knowledge, where we use our intellect, our ability to judge, our ability to analyze, and that analytical knowledge is conceptual knowledge. We have already talked about it. And the intuitive knowledge, the a priori knowledge, which also has been talked about by Immanuel Kant. So, in a way, the basics of Croce's theories are not different than the Kantian theory. What he says further is more important. He says that intuitive knowledge, Kant did not try to differentiate between these three. He said that the intuitive knowledge helps us to recognize the inherent order in the nature. Croce is of the opinion that the aesthetic creation is a product of intuitive knowledge. The other two knowledges, the perceptual knowledge and the conceptual knowledge, cannot give birth to art. It can give birth to knowledge. The other activities of mankind are based on these two knowledges. The creative activity is a product of intuitive knowledge. This is Croce's argument. This is Croce's theory. Rather, he is of the opinion that expression of art is not art. Intuition itself is art. When you intuit, now see, sometimes we mistake intuition with feeling, with sensation. He says one will have to be very careful in understanding the intuition. Feeling or sensation is not intuition. Intuition is something more than that. To intuit is to know without experience. The a priori knowledge is intuition. And once you intuit about the world, the work of art is complete there. When I intuit, that is my, like, and he says that intuition is not necessarily a property of an artist. Now, this actually Crochet is very interesting. Crochet's statements sometimes appear to be contradictory. But at the same time, what he says is sometimes so convincing because it is very clear that Crochet has not witnessed any art activity. Like Plato. Plato also seems to have witnessed the art, but not the art activity. He does not seem to be conversant with the process of creation of art. Even Crochet does not seem to be conversant with that process. And that is why he speaks about art as a final product. Now he says that the artists are not the only people who have intuition. If art is a product of intuition, one may think that the artists have intuition and that is why they create. But he says that the intuition is art. When I intuit, suppose if I want to write a poem, the poem is crystallized in my mind. When I intuit that poem, my art is complete. Once I spell it out, once I write it, it is merely a translation of my intuition. And what I create on the paper or in the stone or on the canvas is merely an imitation of my intuition which lies in my mind. The real work of art is the one which I carry in my mind. What I create on the paper is an imitation of that work of art, and that is why is much lesser to the one which I have created in my mind. Now this is too romantic, but at the same time he has many interesting things to say. Some of them are really very, very convincing. So, and that is why he says that when I read a poem, I do not read your intuition. Do you get my point? Actually, his greatest contribution lies here. Now, once you consider intuition as art, there are so many problems that may occur. One, the work of art which is tangible, which is readable, which is touchable, that work of art is not a real work of art according to Crochet, because that is not a real work of art. If I translate a work of art, suppose I take it as a work of art, if I translate a poem, if I am a faithful translator, then I am a bad translator. Yes, sir. And if it is a good translation, it is not a translation. And if it is a faithful translation, it cannot be a good translation. Because if I try to keep faithful to that original expression, obviously what I create is merely an imitation. And if I try to translate it using my own sensitivity, then I am making a new creation. It is not a translation. It is a new intuition. So he has many such interesting statements. The other debatable statement is he says that intuition is not necessarily an ability of an artist. Everybody has intuition, and that is why it becomes possible for the onlooker to appreciate a work of art. If I don't have intuition, I will not be able to appreciate a work of art. The artist creates something and I respond to it because I also have the same intuition. And the quality of that intuition, the intuition of the artist and the quality of the intuition of the onlooker is not different from each other. If there is a difference, now naturally the question will immediately arise that if the artist also has intuition and the onlooker also has the intuition, then why does the onlooker does not create or cannot create? Then naturally Crochet has to think about it. Crochet has an answer for it. He says, yes, there could be a difference between the intuition of the artist and the intuition of the onlooker. But if there is a difference, the difference could be of degree and not of essence. There is no essential difference between the intuition of the onlooker and the artist. If there is a difference, there is a difference of degree. And in support of his argument, he gives a very interesting explanation. He says that a circle of 3 inches diameter is not less circular than a circle which has a diameter of 3 miles. Or a gram of gold is not less golden than the kilo of a gold. The goldenness is the same, but there is a difference between a kilogram of a gold and a gram of a gold. There is a difference between a small circle and a big circle. So I do admit that there might be a difference, but it is a difference of degree. There is no essential difference between the intuition of the artist and the intuition of a common man, and that is why it becomes possible for the common man to respond to the intuition. Now, this in a way leads to a very interesting phenomenon which was discussed in 20th century, that is of creative criticism. When I critique a work of art, that is also a creation. Appreciation is also a creation. Without creative energy, I cannot, and you will be surprised that something similar has been talked about in Indian aesthetics. In Indian aesthetics, they have used terms like Karayitri Pratibha and Bhavayitri Pratibha. Pratibha is genius. Pratibha is intuition. Now there is an intuition of making things, Karayitri Pratibha. Creative energy and appreciative energy. Creative genius and appreciative genius. A creator may not be an appreciator, and an appreciator may not be a creator. Now this becomes, as I said, that when you read Crochet, sometimes you feel after, while reading it sounds very interesting, after you complete reading it, you think that it doesn't make sense. But when you go back and think about it again, you realize that he has given some very interesting ideas. He has given some very interesting thoughts. And for a practicing artist, these thoughts are very, very important. The practicing artist appreciates Crochet because he has said something which convinces a practicing artist more. Now, this is true that this genius, creating art, is a different kind of genius, and appreciating art is a different kind of genius. If it would not have been so, all the artists would have been good appreciators, but they are not. We know that if you ask the artist to explain a work of art, he may not be able to do that. He may not be able to explain his own work of art. I told a story earlier also, I will repeat it because I really appreciate it, that a Marathi poet wrote a long article about Henry Moore's sculpture. And Henry Moore also wrote an article on the same sculpture, in which Henry Moore's analysis was different than the analysis of this particular poet. When he was asked about it, he said, Henry Moore's job is to create art. Understanding art is my job. When people said that you did not understand the sculpture, he said, Henry Moore did not understand it. Because his job is to create the sculpture. Understanding his sculpture is my job. Which in a way is true, that appreciation of art is a different talent, is a different genius, and Crochet perhaps is the first person to recognize this. At the same time, he has something more to say. Like when I translate my intuition in a work of art, when I create a work of art, it is a translation of my idea. But that is not the real work of art. The real work of art lies here, isn't it? And when you appreciate that particular thing, you do not appreciate that object in front of you, but that object creates another work of art in your mind. This is another interesting, what fascinates me, that there is a very amazing parallelism between some of the aesthetic ideas in Indian aesthetics and Crochet's aesthetics. Now, what he is trying to say, that a work of art is like a stimulus. A work of art is an object. It is an aesthetic object, but it is not a real work of art. We call it a work of art, but that work of art creates a different, it triggers off a particular feeling in my mind. So my intuition gets ignited. My intuition gets activated. And what I enjoy is my intuition, which is awakened. It is not what the artist has created. And that is why an aesthetic object can offer different experiences to different people. I can appreciate, all of us can appreciate a particular work of art, a particular film. Many a times we discuss about the films. Everybody likes a particular film, but you like it for a different reason. She likes it for a different reason. The third person likes it for a different reason. All of us are responding to it, but responding to it for different reasons. Which means that there is a chemistry. that plays a role over there. It is, I always say that it is, you have a chemical with you. The work of art is another chemical. So the end result in your mind is the combination, is the compound of this chemical and the chemical which you are carrying. In his mind, a different compound will come into existence. In the third mind, the third compound will come into existence. So it's a mixture or compound of different chemicals in different minds. You have a different genius, you have a different intuition, she has a different intuition, and that is why the aesthetic experience of every individual is different from each other. This is true. We know that it is true. We know it for sure that it is true. And we did not know the reason behind it. Now, Abhinav Gupta has said something similar about it. Abhinav Gupta says that rasa nirmiti or rasa nishpatti is not the right phraseology. Bharata talks about rasa nishpatti, but he says actually it is rasa jagrati. Because though I am talking about bhavas, there are 9 different bhavas depicted in different works of art which result into rasa. But the rasa is not created from that bhava. If it would have been created, then it becomes an object. A creation leads to ontology. Ontology is existence. Then it is an existence. Where exactly the aesthetic pleasure is created? In the work of art? If it is in the work of art, how does it get transmitted to my mind? Which means that the pleasure does not travel from one place to another. The pleasure is there in my mind, but it is in a dormant state. When I look at a work of art, the pleasure in my mind gets awakened. Croce is almost trying to say the same thing, that you have your intuition in your mind. That intuition gets awakened. Intuition is an experience of an individual. Intuition is not necessarily a privilege of an artist. Every person who has the capacity to appreciate art, appreciate a work of art, is intuitive. That individual intuition gives you the aesthetic pleasure. It's a different way of looking at the aesthetic experience. This is another interesting thing which Croce has said. This thought of Croce gave a different dimension to the critical activity. Creative criticism became extremely popular in the beginning of 20th century, and it suggested several new possibilities to the field of criticism. Later on, there are several debatable thoughts which are presented by Croce. Croce was of the opinion that since a work of art is a product of intuition, there is no need of thinking about the technique or the process of creation or probability, possibility, because if you intuit something, the expression of that intuition is a work of art. So, and if the intuition is not ripe, the work of art will not come into existence. That is one thing. The other debatable thought was, he said that choosing the form for the expression is not the artist's job or is not the artist's privilege even. I cannot decide whether to convert my intuition into a play or a sculpture or a painting or a poem. The intuition will decide whether to get converted. Now this was quite debatable. But the romantists were quite fascinated by this idea. And I remember even in India in those days, about 50 years back, there were people who used to say, they never said, I wrote a poem. A poem happened, a painting happened. You know, people, there are romantic people who say that this is not painted by me. Somebody got it painted through me. This such romantic ideas are the product of this particular thought that intuition takes its own shape. The artist cannot decide what to do with his intuition. Now we know that this is not really true. Rather the form of the art, because particularly a practicing artist, this is almost, I'm sorry to use a very nasty analogy to explain this, but this is almost like he's visualizing art almost like laying an egg, as if the egg gets totally formulated and then it is just delivered. A work of art is not like an egg where it is complete in the mind and is delivered on the paper or on the proscenium. We know that the creative process plays a very crucial role in making of art. In the process of creation, there are so many. When you intuit a work of art and when you produce a work of art, There is a big difference between the two. Many a times what you intuit and what you produce, there is hardly any similarity between the two, because when you start thinking over it, when you start working over it, there are so many changes that take place in it. The technique plays a very important role. The material resists so many of your thoughts, because the material resistance is also a part of creation. So it seems that crochet is not aware of all these resistances which are created in the process of expression, and that is why he has extremely romantic thoughts about creation. But they did influence some of romanticism at that time, and some people appreciated it also. But the technicalities, the role of sudden changes, we know that the artist changes the thought in the process of creation. Many a times there are accidental elements which play a very crucial role. When I am working on my sculpture, I realize that the way I expected my material to react, it is not reacting in a similar fashion, and it is giving some accidental effects which are far more fascinating than the things which I had in my mind. So all these things were not taken into consideration by Crochet, and that is why, though intuition is a very interesting theory, it does not give a thought to the creative process at all. But along with Crochet, even the other thinkers said something similar in this particular period. R.G. Collingwood also said that art is never controlled by reason. Now, Crochet and Collingwood share many things. He also thinks that reason does not play any role in creation of art. Art is never controlled by reason, because it has its own logic. Art has its own logic. The common reasoning doesn't play any role over there. It is like investing emotions in physical medium. I invest my emotions in the physical medium, and whatever comes out of it is my work of art. My reasoning doesn't play any role over there. But the artist does not have, this is very interesting, even Collingwood is of the opinion that the artist does not have any control on selecting the emotion. Like, there are so many emotions in my mind, and every emotion cannot get converted into art. We know that even rasa theory says the same thing, that there are so many bhavas, but only 9 bhavas have been given a status of sthayi bhava. And only sthayi bhava has a capacity to get elevated to the level of rasa. Collingwood says that every emotion gets converted into a work of art, but the artist cannot choose which of his emotions is turning into art. Now, this is another problem which we will have to deal with. We know that the form of the expression and the emotion of the expression is always an artist's selection. Otherwise, there will be, like, the critics obviously did not approve of this thought. They said that this will lead to ambiguity, because this theory is not a theory. There are critics who are of the opinion that this theory is not a theory at all, because it is extremely ambiguous. Then every emotion cannot be an intuition, and every intuition cannot be art. So, and if every emotion gets converted into a work of art, then how are you going to do the value judgment? If creation of art is so subjective, if there are no rules and regulations, if there are no criteria of judgment, then I will create anything and call it intuition. Actually, that's what is happening in different periods, that I create something, and since in postmodern period, there is no criteria of value judgment. Rather, they do not subscribe to the very notion of value judgment. Something similar is being said in this period also, and people were criticizing them of anarchy, because they said that value judgment of this kind of art will be impossible. Bosanquet, though, is an absolute idealist himself and one of the champions of this particular thought. He suggested an alternative. He suggested a theory which I think can answer all this criticism. We know that Crochet and Collingwood, they have something very specific in mind. When they expressed it, people did not approve of it, but a sensitive artist can understand what these people are trying to say. Bosanquet perhaps came with solution. He perhaps suggested the outcome of this thought. when people started criticizing the absolute idealist of being extremely romantic and ambiguous, Bodanke said that though it is not proper, it is not possible to differentiate between a good work of art and a bad work of art. Rather, a good art and bad art is a wrong differentiation. It is either art or no art. Bad art cannot be art at all. So a poem is a poem or it is not a poem. There is nothing like bad poem. There is nothing like bad sculpture. It is not a sculpture. It is not a painting. It is as simple as that. But though it is true, how to differentiate between the two? Who will decide what is a sculpture and what is not a sculpture? And how can you, what is the criteria to do that? Bodanke came up with a very interesting idea, which he calls the easy beauty and the difficult beauty. He said, there is no great art and lesser art. There is no good art and bad art. But there can be difficult art and easy art. We know that a Hindi film song is also a music. And Bada Khayal by Kumar Gandharva is also music. A Bada Khayal by Bade Gulam Ali or Abdul Karim Khan is also music. And a Hindi film song like Mehbooba or Mehbooba is also music. But are we going to differentiate between the two? According to Crochet, Collingwood and other followers of absolute idealism, they say that both these things are music. There is no reason to differentiate between the two. Or there is no reason to differentiate between a toy which is sold in a weekly market of a village and Michelangelo's Pieta. According, theoretically, there is no difference between the two. Both of them are the products of the intuition of two different people. And if it is a product of intuition, it is a good work of art. It is a work of art. We cannot compare them. It is a wrong idea to compare two works of art. But we know that Pieta is Pieta and a toy is a toy. So how to differentiate between the two? Bodanke says that the elements and the principles that are used in these two works of art are not different from each other. We know that the seven notes which are used by Kumar Gandharva are the same seven notes which are used by a Hindi film music musician or a tribal singer who is singing on the roads. He uses the same seven notes. He uses the same musical logic which is used by the classical musician. So principally, there is no difference between the two. In principle, they are the same. But we know, we can see that there is a difference. How to judge the difference? He says that one of them is an example of difficult beauty. Not greater beauty, difficult beauty. And the other is an example of simple beauty or easy beauty. The difficult beauty is complex, obviously. There is complexity in it. And one has to construct it with great efforts. But the most important thing between the difficult beauty and the easy beauty is the high tension of emotions. He says that some works of art have the capacity to bear the high tension of emotions. When you read Mahabharata, you have to have the patience to sustain that pressure. It gives you high tension and it is an emotional tension. The people who do not have a capacity to sustain that tension cannot read Mahabharata. Or the same is true about a good film. A film like Devdas, original Devdas, troubles you. It doesn't give you pleasure. Or a film like Kali Yuga, a film like Junoon, will trouble you. You need the capacity to bear that tension. And otherwise, most of the people do not like such films because they do not have the capacity to bear that tension. The same is true about music. Great music is not entertaining. If you want to listen to Kumar Gandharva, it is not entertainment for 3 hours. It is very demanding. A difficult work of art is very demanding. It asks for a lot of repay from the listener. You have to bear that tension. You have to give that attention. So most of the people do not want to listen to this kind of music because they don't have a capacity to bear this tension, to meet the demands of the work of art. Then the understanding between the reality, the truth and the myth. This is also very interesting. Like initially, to bear the complexity is one thing. To bear the tension of emotions is another thing. And the third is, if you do not have a proper understanding of reality and truth, you will never understand what the artist is trying to do. To understand a joke, even very few people, we say that that person doesn't have a sense of humor. What does that mean? That basically he doesn't even realize that this is a humor. And why does he fail to understand that it is a humor? Because he fails to understand the difference between the reality and the falsehood. When he recognizes that what is being told to me is not reality, then only he recognizes it as a joke. So a proper understanding of reality is extremely necessary to respond to difficult art. Because difficult art always tries to portray reality in various perspectives. Reality, it is not merely a reflection of reality. A great work of art does not hold mirror to the society, does not hold mirror to the reality. It interprets reality. And if you do not know reality properly, it will be impossible for you to understand that interpretation. To understand that interpretation, you will have to understand the difference between the two. Most of the people do not understand it, and that is why fail to understand the complexity of difficult beauty. So, this complexity, sustaining the complexity, having the ability to sustain the tension, emotional tension, and the discerning eye to recognize the difference between the reality and the interpretation of the reality. Because many times it becomes humorous, sometimes it becomes tragic, sometimes it becomes sarcastic, sometimes it becomes, you know, there are various ways of showing reality. So recognizing all those differences is extremely important for the viewer. The people who do not understand it, subscribe to a simpler version of it. There are political pictures, like I remember a film in which the hero becomes a chief minister for one day and changes the whole state in 24 hours. Now that is a part of wishful thinking, and a common man appreciates it because it is more palatable and it is easy to accept. This is an example of easy beauty. Easy beauty is always pleasing, and that is why if you ask a common man ki why doesn't he see a particular picture, he would say that why should I spend from my pocket and buy a headache for 3 hours? I see films to feel good. So when I spend so much of money, I want something which pleases me. I want something which entertains me. So why does he say so? Because he opts for easy beauty. Most of the people do not have the capacity to face that tension, and that is why they opt for easy beauty. And the popular art is an example of easy beauty. The classical art is an example of difficult beauty. So we will not differentiate between the two, saying that the popular art is lesser art and the classical art is greater art. There is no difference of lesser and greater. There is a difference of complex and simple. And simple obviously has to be more popular. So if the value judgment has to be done, it can be done in this particular manner. Qualitative value judgment may not be a correct attempt for a critic. So this gives a broad idea about the influence of Kantian thought on creation and appreciation of art, which certainly influenced the art of late 19th century. It influenced the criticism of 19th century, and obviously as the criteria was formulated in that fashion, it also affected the art production to some extent in this particular period. So this is influence of absolute idealism lived for a very long time till the beginning of 20th century, when formalism was introduced to the realm of art.